want to give a special thanks to our founding partner, Government of Bavaria. And anyway, there's David. He's our host. And I'm the organizer. Forgot to say that. Come on up, David.
All right. Very good. So Lauren Keeson, organizer of Disruptive Technologists. She is the queen bee. Queen bee. Very good. Okay. So as she said, Bavaria.org is a founding. Now, I don't know if you know what this is. Like Bavaria, you know, as in Bavaria. So they actually have this really impressive development organization that is attempting to really reach out, obviously, internationally. And it's very, very progressive. So check it out. It's Bavaria.org. So it's the high-tech center of Europe, as they say. We've got more sponsors. There's a lot of team members that make this whole thing work. Hint Water. So if any of you are drinking that delicious, refreshing liquid beverage with just a hint of flavor, that's Hint Water. So thank you to Hint. And we've also got Funding Post, although they didn't bring pizza. They brought sandwiches. So those gourmet, delicious, high-end sandwiches that make pizza look like pauper food that you are now...
That's a big upgrade.
Yes, that's a huge upgrade. So enjoy that. That's coming from Funding Post. And then the coffee. The best coffee you've ever tasted. That comes from Marley Coffee. So hopefully you caught it. It's kind of all the way at the end. If you have to get it on the way out to kind of like get your after-party, you know, game on, do it. Marley Coffee. That's right-hand Marley. It's Bob Marley's son. Wonderful, wonderful coffee. And then we've also got Harry Greenlee. Greenlee, is he here? Did I see him? He's not actually here.
He's coming.
But hopefully he will make it. He is a commercial realty professional, and he's been the one who will provide mentorship to anybody who's looking for commercial space. So that's very useful. And we also have a very interesting thing tonight. This is called Snapped.us, Snap.us, but Snapped.us. And this is a photo, and what was your name again?
Edward.
So look for Edward. See, he's hiding in the back. He's kind of, you know, in stealth mode. But Edward's there. He's going to be taking pictures, and these pictures will be available in hard copy within, was it, 24 hours? Oh, amazing service. So look for him. You'll get your picture. It's free. And have him take your picture. It'll be really cool, and you'll actually see a physical picture, which is like, I haven't seen one of those in, what, 10 years now? And then finally, we've got Jolie McPhee in the back is doing videography for the event tonight. He's part of the Internet Society, and he is the one that makes sure that all this good stuff is available to everybody out on the Internet every single time. And... finally, let me introduce our moderator for the evening. So, Kevin Pianco will be moderating. He's a partner of Wiser Mazar.
I lead our technology and media communication practice. I have two of our associates here, Dick Fulton and Gil Avnet. We're located here in New York, global firm, and we just love technology. So any way we could support Lauren and her team, we'd love to be here. So what we're going to do tonight, we're going to start off, I'm going to introduce Jeremy Braff, and then I'll introduce his associates after Jeremy gives a 20-minute speech, and then I'll give you time for some questions. Great opportunity, great organization. We're so happy to have you guys here. So Jeremy is a software architect. First of all, he's a software architect for MLB Advanced Media. In this role, he has spearheaded the design and creation of a central API of sports data used both by internal teams and external partners. On top of that, he's worked on an analytics engine called StatCast, which is used to evaluate the movement of athletes in real time during a game. That must be something. I'm waiting to hear about that. The engine's output provides fans and professional teams with a novel way to assess a player's abilities and skills that was previously impossible. As both a sports fan and a data nerd, self-described, I did not write that, Jeremy's overarching goal is to make sports data easily accessible to all fans. Jeremy, please take the podium.
All right. Hi, everyone. I'm Jeremy Braff. I'm a software architect for MLB Advanced Media, which is the tech arm for Major League Baseball. Today, I'm going to talk about how we're changing the way that sports data is distributed. It's important to know that despite our name, we really are more than just a baseball company. With over 115 partners, including Sony, including HBO, ESPN, and WWE, for these partners, we're able to build streaming platforms as well as mobile solutions and websites. Today, I'm going to be talking about our more sports-focused application, which was building an API that was able to unify Major Baseball, NHL, and PGA, the data that they're returning. So this API is really going to give us a central source for all this data. MLB Advanced Media has been around for over 15 years. In that time, we've generated a lot of different data stores, as well as many different ways of retrieving that data. You can see some up there. As we partnered with NHL and PGA, we gained even more data stores and even more ways to grab the data. This, unfortunately, was a problem for our clients, as they really wanted one central place to get all their data needs. So my team was tasked with building an API to sit in front of all this data and unify it into one response. So this API was going to be used by our websites, our mobile apps, our connected devices, which is Roku, Xbox, PlayStation, professional sports teams, third parties, and hopefully in the future, the public. When we decided to build this API, we had a few design goals we wanted to accomplish. First, it had to be easy to use. It had to be flexible, had to be fast, had to allow for real-time updates, had to be scalable, and lastly, it had to be expandable to other sports in the future. So let's talk how we accomplish each of these. Let's start off with easy to use. For an API, easy to use is an interesting thing. For us, it meant following as many standards as we could. We knew that all of our clients knew how to use REST APIs and get JSON responses, so we didn't want to reinvent the wheel, so we just decided to use that. We also wanted to unify the response across all sports. So if you want information about a baseball team, and then you want information about a hockey team, you should be able to request the data the same way and get the same response back in the end. By doing this, our client's job and the fans will have a lot easier to grab this data. We also want to make sure this is well documented with all the third parties. The more documentation we have, the less questions they have to ask for us, which makes our life a lot easier. Now that we know how to make it easy to use, let's talk about how we're going to make it flexible. As you saw on a previous slide, we have a lot of different clients accessing our data and all have different needs. Our websites have a large screen space and want to use a lot of data, while our mobile clients with a smaller screen might want to display less data. So we want to make sure this API could handle all these different use cases. We did this with something called expands. Up here, you'll see one of our API calls and the actual response from it. So this is our schedule API call. It's a very simple API. It just returns data about today's schedule. You'll notice some interesting things there. We have the game time, we have status of the game, whether it started yet, what's happening with it, as well as information about the teams playing. I want you to look at the part that's circled in red, or in the red square box, the team information. By default, we only return the ID and names for teams. For our mobile clients, this is all they need to be able to create a schedule page, so they love this. Unfortunately, our websites need a lot more information. So we allow them to expand this information using what we call an expand. So this is the same exact API call, but with the parameter added, expand equals schedule.teams. The response that you're seeing is the same response as before, but the only difference is what's in the red. Now, instead of just getting a small amount of information about the team, you're grabbing a lot of information about the team, such as the team's location, the first year they played, what division they're in, as well as various other things. So this allows our website, by using the same call, to get a lot more data. The great thing about expands are they're actually recursive. Once you start the expands, you can keep going. So our web team said, that's great, we have the team information. Next, we want to get back the entire team roster. So they add the expand team.rosters, and suddenly you get the entire roster back for the team. And you could keep going levels on. Next, you could get the player stats using the same API call and keep on iterating down, which means with one call, the website could get a massive amount of data, which allows them to build their screen with just one API call. So that's great for websites, but not necessarily so good for mobile apps. Mobile apps are a lot more bandwidth constrained, so they're concerned about grabbing a lot of data. So for them, we allow them to filter out what data is being received. So again, we have the mobile apps calling the schedule API endpoint. And this time, they actually have a requirement where they want to have a page that shows an entire season schedule, but only the amount of games played on each day. So they do the same API call for schedule, say they want the entire season data, but they only want to know how many games are played. So they pass in this fields parameter and say they just want the total items back. And as you see, the response they get back is the schedule, but only the amount of items. So this is great. It means with one API, you can have websites grabbing a lot of information about one day, while our mobile apps get a small amount of information over the entire season. So now that we made it flexible and easy to use, we need to try and make it fast. Our goal was to have each API call be sub 50 milliseconds. Nothing's worse than hitting an API requesting data and having it take 5 to 6 seconds for responses. Spinning in sub 50 milliseconds was a fun challenge. Part of the problem was some of the data sources we have can be a little slow, especially with the expands where we're trying to grab back hundreds of different data points at the same time. For example, when you expand the schedule information and grab player stats, that is hitting across multiple different data stores and requesting hundreds of different pieces of data. And when data sources aren't super fast, this starts slowing down. So we got around this by making sure to cache all of our calls to the API. We use a system called Memcache for this, which is a, for those guys who don't know what that is, it's a distributed key value store as a quick way to retrieve data. Our caching mechanism is actually fairly complicated and probably take me an hour or two to kind of go into the cool aspects of it. So if you have questions about it, I definitely recommend asking me afterwards. But we'll go on from there. Many years ago, I had a boss who told me that a good developer is a lazy developer. I don't know if that's true or not, but I took that to heart. And when I write code, I try and assume that whoever's going to take over the code frame next is going to be one of those lazy developers. So to do that, we tried to make sure that caching was easy to do within our API. We did this using an open source annotation library online called Simple Spring Memcache. For Java developers out there, this all probably looks at least somewhat familiar. If you're not a Java developer, I'm going to quickly run through this so you understand kind of how easy it is to do. The get teams, you see that last line, the public list get teams, is defining a method that says when you call this, get back team information. This will then end up hitting the database and retrieving data back, which can be slow. So to add caching to it, you add that line before, the at read through multicache. What that's doing is telling the Java code that whenever this method's called, first check to see if it's in cache, and if so, return it. Otherwise, go use this method to get the data the slower way. By adding this annotation, it made things very, very easy to cache and made sure no developer forgot to add caching to their calls. So I discussed how we want to make this sub 50 milliseconds. Up here, you'll see a screen from an application called New Relic, which is a great tool for monitoring your apps and finding performance issues. One of the other things it does is it will give you a nice graph showing you how quick your API is. So this graph, I don't know how easy it is to see out there, but the one on the left is graphing out the average response time across our entire API. For those with good eyesight, you'll see that the average response time is, even the worst case scenario, is around 35 milliseconds, which, considering all the expands we have, is incredibly fast, and we're very happy about that. You'll also notice that there are some valleys there where we have much, much quicker response times, which the reason why that happens is actually kind of interesting. If you look on the graph on the right, the bottom right-hand corner, it's a throughput graph, which is how many users are using our API at the same time. So you'll notice, if you correlate the two of them together, the higher the throughput we have, the quicker the API actually is, which might seem counterintuitive unless you understand caching. What this means is when we have more users using our system, they're more likely to hit the cache data versus hitting the data store, which means our API speeds up, which is really great for scaling because it means as we get more and more users, our API just gets faster and faster. All right, so we're a sports company. It's very important that we have real-time updates. When someone hits a home run, our mobile site needs to show that in real time. If we're waiting 10, 15 seconds to show this, people are not going to use our apps. So we need to make sure when something happens, within a couple milliseconds, it's showing up live. With normal data stores, this isn't too bad. But when you're trying to cache everything to make it fast, it's very difficult. So I said before, with caching, everyone's kind of retrieving the same data, and we need a way to update the cache. So we came up with three ways that we were going to update the cache. One's for our long-tail content. Long-tail content for us is data that's not really accessed that much and doesn't really change. An example of long-tail content is one of our clients might want to look up the Major League Baseball standings on July 8, 1964. This is never going to change, and it's rarely going to be requested. So what we do in this case is when someone requests that, we'll reach out, check if it's in the cache. If it's not, we'll go and grab it from the data stores, aggregate all the data, return it to the client, and then toss it into cache. We'll leave in cache for upwards of a couple of weeks. Since this data is not changing, that's perfect. It means that the next couple of weeks, everyone who requests this data will get it very quickly. We considered caching it forever, but it turns out with how little this data is used, it was just a waste of memory to store it for more than a couple of weeks. We have other data that may need much more real-time updates, which I explained before was when someone hits a home run. Fortunately for baseball, we control the entire infrastructure from getting the data from the field and into our system. we actually have some people called stringers who sit at the ballpark and click a button every time something happens on the field. So someone gets a hit, they click a button, and immediately it triggers some updates. One of the updates it does is put a message on what's called a message queue, which our API is listening to. When the API notices that there's an update, it'll read this from the message queue and then flush the cache to make sure we have the most up-to-date data. So that means within a few milliseconds of our stringer clicking that a play happened, it's showing up live in our API. Unfortunately, we don't necessarily control all of our data stores. For example, NHL has a similar system to us where they have five people at a hockey game clicking on what happens. Hockey's a lot more complicated, so you need more people doing this. But they don't have a way of notifying us when there's a state change. Instead, they make a feed available to us, which we pull every second looking for updates. So when someone scores a goal in the NHL, within a second, we're able to detect that the feed changed and update our cache and push this data out to our clients so they can see live what's happening in the NHL games. Now that we've handled the real-time updates, we had to look into how we can scale this out. It's with sports, we know when our users are most likely going to be using our API. During live games, we're going to have tens of millions of users all trying to request data from our API to see what's happening. During off hours, we're going to get a lot less users. So we need to come up with a way that our system can handle all these users while also not costing us a lot of money when games are not happening. So this first bullet point is actually fairly outdated, but we launched the NHL API approximately in the middle of this past season. That night, we had a few games going on, and during our opening night, we were noticing approximately 30,000 requests per second coming to our API. Since then, especially when it comes to the playoffs, we've blown those numbers out of the water. And we add in baseball, which is a more popular sport, we have multiple times that amount of requests per second. So we accomplished this by a few things. One, having a well-written code that made good use of caching. But two, we used Amazon Web Services, or AWS, for having our servers there. For those guys who aren't familiar with this, Amazon provides cloud computing. All of our servers for this API are actually stored in Amazon. They have a nifty feature called auto-scaling groups. What the auto-scaling groups does is it can add more machines to take traffic when necessary. So when the load starts getting, we added a trigger to our auto-scaling group that just looks for load across our servers. When it sees load going up, which means we have a lot of users, it's able to add more machines and immediately help us scale to the numbers we need. When the load goes down, it's able to remove those servers and save us on cost. We were able to go even a step further with this by using our own APIs. So we wrote some scripts that pull our API on a regular basis, looking for when games were starting. When it noticed the game started, it knew that load was going up. So when that happens, it added more machines into our server farm and allow more machines to take traffic. And then when it noticed that the game were ending by using the schedule, it'd be able to remove these machines and save us on costs. Okay, expandable to other sports. So we briefly discussed this before, how we want to make this API universal across all sports. A baseball team is very similar to a hockey team. So if you know how to get information about a baseball team, you should also know how to get information from a hockey team. So that's what we did from our clients. But we also want to make sure it's easy for our API developers to add new sports in. This, again, if you're a Java developer, this might make sense. If not, I'll try and make it understandable. But Java has this thing called interfaces, which is pretty much just a contract saying, I'm going to do something. So this is our contract for the team data. This says, when we add a new team sport, we need to make sure to add getTeam and getTeams method. It's not saying how it's being implemented. It's just saying we need to add this eventually. So when we go to add a new sport, we basically do a copy of the code. And these interfaces immediately light up saying, hey, you did something wrong. You need to implement this before you can launch. So when we add a new sport, you just go in, find all the problems, all the places where the interface said you didn't implement it, write code for it, and run the unit test. Once it's all passed, we know we're ready to launch. So this means when we launch a new sport, we know it's going to work correctly, and we also know that we accomplished all the goals we wanted with this API. OK, so what can we do with this data? This is where it gets exciting. Last year, we launched something called StatCast. StatCast involved putting some very high-end cameras and radar systems into every single one of our major league ballparks. These cameras are insanely good. They're able to track where players are at all time, be able to track the ball at all times, the spin of the baseball, how hard it was hit, and various other metrics. So we had these cameras at the ballpark, which was passing these live streams of data back to our system. With this system, we were able to run a bunch of analytics on it. In fact, we calculate close to 100 metrics based on the video for each play. When this comes into our system, we run the metrics, and then we flush the API cache so this data goes live. This means that we can give our mobile clients some interesting data after play ends. For example, we can say that Giancarlo Stanton just hit that ball at 125 miles per hour, and our fans might be interested by that. But we also take this data and push it directly back to our broadcasters and allow them to use this for instant replays and use all these live metrics. So I'm going to show you a video of our usage of this and kind of walk through. So this was a play that happened last month during one of the Mets game. Well hit ball that a fantastic catch on. So the broadcasters will show this live, and then the data comes in, and using our StatCast data, they're now able to add in new metrics immediately. So for example, we're able to see that it took him 0.27 seconds to react once the ball was hit. He ran 18.4 miles per hour, he ran 91 feet, and he had a route efficiency of 96.6%. Just some great information, very exciting for the fans. We also show that this guy, the ball was hit 112 miles per hour, and it's travel 395 feet. So this is all done in near real time. The moment a play ends, we have this data out to our fans using our apps and to our broadcasters, which really can change the way that baseball is seen and analyzed. So when we built this, we wanted to have 100% uptime, and so far we've pretty much accomplished this. We've had no real outages, so that's always good. That's thanks to partially all of our monitoring tools we have set up, Kibana, Grafana, New Relic, Sensu, and we use PagerDuty for waking us up in the middle of the night in case something does go wrong. There's a lot we want to do in the future. We want to move more towards microservices. We want to add WebSockets for quicker ways to get the data to our clients. And we'd like to add more sports. So if any of these things excite you or interest you, this was actually built by a really small team. There's three core developers working on it. Actually, two of the other ones are here tonight, Emily and Chris, if you guys want to know. Chris back there. I don't see where Emily is. She's somewhere. You know, come talk to us later. There she is. come talk to us later if you're interested in this. You know, we're looking to expand the team. And we actually just love talking about the APIs. So if you have more questions, come chat with us. So, questions. Yes.
Wait. Oh. Okay, let me rehearse. So in the beginning, you mentioned all of the things that were important when you were first building the API. One thing I didn't see was security of it. So is that ever an issue, or did you ever think about future data breaches, and was that even important to you guys at this point?
Yeah, so some of our data is secured, which, you know, a lot of the StatCast data is secured and only are accessible by broadcasters and Major League Baseball teams. So in that case, we built security features around that to make sure that no one can access that. Most of us have pretty good experience in building security platforms, so we're able to add in the security behind it. But for the most part, we don't really have a strong security use case for this data. So it wasn't one of our core API goals at the time. About something that is definitely considered.
So I'm a little bit more curious on the side of the actual like data generation. Is that covered by the AM umbrella, or is it like, do you guys consume from other vendors regarding like the real-time stats, et cetera, et cetera?
Sure, yeah, so that's all, for baseball, it's all generated by us. So I mentioned before the stringer is entering real-time data into it. We also have, basically our databases contain everything that's happened in Major League Baseball history, from play-by-play to full stats for all those things. So we generate all that data. It's all self-contained. We have entire teams built around kind of maintaining and updating this data and finding more optimal ways to store it. And especially interesting with the StatCast, because StatCast actually provides a large amount of data. Like for each play, we have basically a couple megs worth of data on that actual play. So storing and being able to access that data efficiently has been an interesting problem we've had to solve. Yes, question up here.
Can you just talk a little bit about the message queue technology you guys chose, and what were your metrics for choosing what queue?
Sure, yeah. We looked at a couple of different things. A lot of the systems in Major League Baseball currently use ActiveMQ, so we use that for some of it. But since we're in the AWS infrastructure, we use some of the tools they built, such as Kinesis for messaging, which has actually worked quite well for us. I don't know how familiar you are with those, but it's been a very good messaging tool. So they answer a couple of ways.
So I guess that you guys carry the baseball records, the regular old stats, the old-fashioned stats.
Yeah. Maybe.
What about the StatCast? Is that guaranteed? Is it something that's going to be, you know, going forward forever? And is it, you know, like redundant? Is it guaranteed to be always delivered, you know, for every game? Or
So we make sure, so with some very minor exceptions, basically every play is tracked by StatCast in Major League Stadiums right now. Going forward, you know, we've liked the system so far. So as far as I can tell, in the near future, we're going to keep going with it. I guess, did that kind of answer your question?
Garen, I was just wondering about the technology.
Wait, can you wait just a second?
I can repeat what he says.
No, we need it for the video. It gets really slow.
Okay.
Sorry.
I was just wondering about the technology behind guaranteed delivery of all those radar and all those sensors at every ballpark.
We've definitely added in a lot of monitoring and stuff like that. So if we miss a play in StatCast, we have all these alerts going out letting us know that something's wrong, so we can go and look at whether if there's a problem with the stadium, like the power went out, or if something got tripped up. So we have very good monitoring to make sure that we cover as many of the plays as possible. I don't have the metrics in front of me, but we cover virtually every single play. And also, all this data, since it's a video, can be resent later. So if there is ever an issue, we have it on video and radar, so we almost never lose a play. We could resend entire plays versus StatCast data. So.
Thanks, Jeremy. We have to end this.
Great.
You did a great job.
Okay, now we're going to have our panel discussion, and I'm going to have the gentleman join us. If we could just come on up. That was a really cool presentation by Jeremy. I thought that was fantastic. Has anybody had a chance to go to their website, the company's website? Did you all see the Matt Harvey video? Anybody see the Matt Harvey video originally on CBS when it came out? It's a good chance. It's pretty cool. He's interviewing people, and half the people don't even know who it's Matt Harvey asking the questions. So having said that, okay, let's get started here. I'm going to introduce, to my left is James. James Ballmer, he's the Director of Search and Personalization. He's responsible for delivering scalable and automated search and personalization products for each of MLBAMs. Can I use that abbreviation, guys? You all right with that? Sure. Jennifer, is that okay? You're the boss. Okay. Sports and Entertainment Partners. Formerly at the New York Times, he built the company's search archives and semantic platforms and won 3 Publishers Awards. There he focused on building distributed systems, machine learning for continuous improvement of search relevance quality, and automation and testing for continuous delivery. He brought his publishing industry experience to MLBAM to build the next generation of search and analytics engine, personalized recommendations platform, and technical search engine optimization infrastructure. Did I get that right?
It's verbose, but correct.
Yes.
I didn't write it. Talk to Jennifer. All right. Then we have Alex sitting next to James. Alex is a senior director of iOS and Android engineering. Get that?
Yep.
His team's responsible for building and maintaining dozens of applications across all iOS and Android platforms. Since joining MLBAM 6 years ago as a mobile engineer, he has helped grow the iOS and Android engineering team from a small 7-person group in New York, working on a single app, to almost 70 people across the country, working on dozens of media industry top apps. He continues to drive his team along the bleeding edge of technological evolution with a strong focus on delivering their users profoundly new yet incredibly organic experiences. That I need clarification on, but we'll go for that. All right? That changed the way they consume both data at home and on the go. Next to Alex is Michael. Thanks for sitting in order of the pictures. I appreciate that.
Yeah,
that was good. Yeah. Michael's responsible for the back end. I'm sorry?
It's all luck.
I know. I think Jennifer's sitting out there like that. Michael's senior director of software engineering. He's responsible for back end services that power MLBAM's mobile apps as well as live video streaming across mobile, web, and connected devices. Prior to MLBAM, You worked at Amazon.com in the payments organization and at Lockheed Martin. Can you tell us any secrets out of Lockheed, or are you still on the prohibitive voice?
No comment.
All right, there you go. In Washington, D.C., on proprietary projects. Sorry. While he's not looking for good beer, he's living and dying with his beloved New York Mets. Okay, you suffered through a lot of years, but we'll give you the benefit of the doubt on that. Last but not least, Roger Williams. He's the Senior Vice President of Media Operations. He leads the team responsible for fulfillment of all media on a 24/7 basis. This includes all live and delivered video on demand content for all contracted and requested platforms, properties, and partners. He's been employed by MLBAM for over 10 years, and you just got your LinkedIn. You told me you got your LinkedIn anniversary notice. That's good.
Correct.
He has a BBA and MBA from the University of Texas at Austin. Great place. Did you spend a lot of time down there, South by Southwest, in Edwell?
Because of March Madness and baseball, I haven't been to March Madness for about 10 years.
Okay, that's good. That's good. All right. When not delivering media content to the teamy masses, he enjoys consuming media like regular civilian. Tasty brown whiskey. Any particular flavor?
Rye whiskey.
All right, so good. Sounds good. Okay. So there's our panel. So let's get going. So seriously, I was briefed on some questions I could ask, some I can't, but that's okay. I appreciate that. How fun is it to work at MLBAM? I have to ask you a question. I mean, it's got to be one of the best things you can do, to do what you love.
I'll start.
Please do.
I would say the fun pretty much revolves around the challenging work that you have to do. There's nothing quite like the intensity of deadlines that don't move. Opening day does not move. Game of Thrones does not move. March Madness does not move. So all these things are very hard deadlines that we have to meet together. And through that, you get to appreciate a high degree of coordination. There's not a lot of red tape, bureaucracy, in how we work. We always work cross-functional. So back-end development works very closely with client-side development, works very closely with services, and my team on operations, including infrastructure and systems as well. So through these pretty demanding deadlines that we have to work through, it's actually very, I'm very appreciative of the experience to actually get a chance to work with a wide breadth of very talented people on a very rapid timetable.
So if I had to interpret that means you're watching everything on tape delay because you don't have the chance to see it in the moment, right?
I would say that the business side of me says it's all signal, but I do enjoy a lot of the content. And frankly, from everything we do, that it's 155 partners, I think it was identified, but we pretty much, for example, for baseball, we capture and encode and stream three different ways for three different partners and three different properties. And it's beyond sports as well. So there's a lot of what you expect from television network, pay TV content that we do encode. So almost everything that's on the United States, either broadcast or special delivered streams, we have our fingers in and we capture and deliver.
Anybody else want to comment?
Yeah, I was just going to say that. Oops, sorry, too loud.
It's all right.
I got a chance to work on our digital ticketing project, which our ballpark app, you can bring up tickets to go to any game in any MLB stadium. And that was a real opportunity to really like work with the clubs, which is pretty cool, pretty baseball unique. Trips to the stadiums to actually test that the tickets were working and, you know, work hand in hand with all the ticketing operations. So it's an example of certainly what we do goes way beyond baseball, but there's definitely those opportunities where you really do feel like part of the industry and part of the league.
Okay. Jim, can we get into a technical question?
Okay.
All right. How do you approach building scalable search systems?
I would say that for anybody familiar with search at all, you know that there are the basic tools out there, Elasticsearch and Solr Cloud. They scale automatically. You can kind of click a button and they scale horizontally. But that's a very tiny portion of the job. When you're actually building a search index, you're scaling on many other sides of it. So you're building an ingestion pipeline. You have to build all of your tooling around it. And so a lot of it has to do with making sure that you have visibility into the systems that you're building, building your tools, building your process, and making sure that when your data winds its way from the beginning stage where it's produced in 1,000 different places, from this CMS to this system to this system to this other website that you're scraping, to all of the rules that go into transforming that data into something usable, that's 99% of the job right there. And so it's so important to have the tooling around the visibility into that process, being able to inspect the data at every point in a pipeline. There's just so much complexity in there that without the tooling, you're lost from day one if you don't have it.
Okay. A few questions throughout the process, feel free to raise your hand. We'll catch you as we go along rather than wait till the end. Let's jump over to Alex. How do you stay on top of new technology?
That's a good question.
It's written for me, so it's easy.
Yeah, it's, part of it is being passionate about the platforms that I help manage. But I think the key is hiring people that are passionate and kind of building a culture of teaching and learning. One of our core values is never stop learning. And so kind of enforcing that through things like tech talks internally. We have a weekly iOS meeting where all the iOS guys will get together, and one person is responsible for teaching the group something that they've learned that's new. And same with Android, we do the same every week. And so I think it's just kind of building that culture of teaching each other new things, because there's just so much that's changing so quickly. As an industry, it's impossible for every person to stay on top of it themselves. So I think that's kind of how we've been so good about being on the bleeding edge. It's just we hire people that love doing this, and those people teach each other all of the new stuff.
To stay on that, how's the quality of the talent coming across your desk?
The quality's great. You know, the problem that we and every tech company faces these days is just it's not very frequent that we get people. It's definitely a job seeker's market in that respect. It's a booming industry, and I think, you know, people are just not learning, I guess, in school and stuff, all of this new stuff. And so, like, we've kind of, we've got a little bit of a shortage, but the people that we do get generally are great, so.
I just wanted to add to the technology question, you know, because of our position in with streaming live events, we really are sort of the leading player in that space when you talk about live events at scale streaming over the internet. And so, you know, we're in some ways defining the technology, you know, where I think that there are people, you know, within our group who are inventing stuff, you know, to support whether it be, you know, a new way to stream video or a new way to encode video or, you know, a new way to handle that kind of scale and support that type of model. I think that's one of the things that makes me excited about BAM and the things that we do is, you know, we're just positioned like few others are in terms of the sports we stream and the events that we stream. So we get to invent stuff. So I think maybe sometimes others are keeping up with us.
Interesting point, Michael. So when you're talking about the proprietary aspect of what you do to protect that, how do you share that? Because to Alex's point, trying to find people with that talent level, do you ever have the opportunity to go back into academia and present and share your ideas?
We sit on a bunch of different boards that are, you know, within the technology space, specifically the streaming video space. And, you know, we're defining these, a lot of these open standards, you know, not necessarily that they're proprietary, but that they're brand new. And we are, you know, working with the larger streaming community. I mean, that's part of, these things work better when they're standards and everyone is doing them the same way. And there's sort of common formats at each point. And so I think what we do is pretty open. It's just new.
Is there particular boards or organizations that the crowd here should know about that they may not know?
Gosh, I don't remember all. I mean, there's one recently on the way that you measure quality of service, but I'm blanking on the names of those various boards, so I'll have to get back to you.
Streaming Video Alliance, and I would say a lot of what we've been doing, there's the official angles, and then there's actually working through the key players in the industry. I don't know, can you guys hear me?
Yeah,
okay?
Yes, yeah. Good.
And bring about the standards of what we're talking about. So all the talk of cord cutting and cord nevering, all of this is actually still very nascent field. And so to have media that can be distributed efficiently, to have media that can be protected with portable DRM standards, to have media that can play nice with ad insertion or ad delivery and monetization, all of that actually has not been fully, it's not in a mature state. And so there's now more than ever been a willingness on the key players in the industry, to the giants, including your Apples, your Googles, your Adobes, your Microsofts, to really coordinate and work together on some common standards. And fortunately and thankfully, we are very much a participant in our key members, or a lot of those discussions. So our hope is there's a certain proprietary nature of how we apply a lot of these technology decisions and how we go to market, but ultimately we want the entire boat to rise. We want a common acceptable format. So your Rokus will develop a client that actually can play nice with some of these standards that are ultimately will be implemented. Your Apples, your iOS, your Androids. So the notion of proprietary with standards only helps to a point. You want buy-in from all the key players in the industry.
Okay. Michael, question for you, and again, I'm gonna, it's a little oxymoron here, this question compared to what you just said as far as leading the trends, but are there any changing technology trends that you see that you guys need to catch up on that you may be not where you want to be?
I'd say one area where we're sort of just a little bit newer to the party is sort of containerizing our applications, or our back-end applications. You know, service deployment historically, very historically sort of deployed a bare iron, then sort of moved to images on a machine, and now people are deploying with these sort of containerized environments. Docker's obviously the major technology. I think, you know, that's an area where we're now investing in, but we're a little bit behind the times in terms of how to really take advantage of, you know, cloud services and the data centers we do own. So I'd say that might be an area where we're investing in now, but I feel like a little bit behind, behind sort of where the industry is.
Considering the audience, yes.
One sec.
No microphone. Anybody have a microphone?
Please. Thank you. We'll share. So two-sided question. One side is, given the multi-platform environment we're in, what have you all had to do, what has the organization had to do to adapt or anticipate the fan experience and how you put out your information and visuals across platform? And the complete other side, which is to ask you to think and give us a peek into the future as to what kind of technologies and services you are working on now that you can talk about that will be the next generation of fan experience in streaming, again, in the context of the multi-platform cross-channel environment.
Question. It's not on my paper. Sorry, guys.
It works twofold. There's product conceptualization. There's things that we want to bring forward, whether it's rich contextual data, whether it's high-end video. And then on the other side, there's the consumption platforms of what can you consume, what can you treat. So it's at the risk of oversimplification, we're trying to up the quality of video content that can be distributed over the present-day bandwidth limitations. I'm somewhat limited in what I can share on that, but that's one of our key goals. And the other side, just like StatCast, is really the capture monetization, but also the mining of that data to make it rich and contextual for export users or engage users. And then third, there's another level of capture. So how you actually capture a live event, there right now it's a bit of a math problem, but you actually can get to the point of where a temporal and spatial notion of what you're capturing from cameras can actually, within a live video context, allow you to zoom in, zoom out, pan around within a live event context. And then we are still going through, you know, a bit of a bake-off when it goes to an accounts for VR as well.
So. Yeah, and just touching on the more feature non-video side of that, we have, basically we've got product folks that operate across different platforms. And so there'll be a product owner for a given property. And they're responsible for trying to build a kind of a unified experience across Android and iOS. But the reason we have platform-specific engineering groups is because there's certainly some expertise built there, and we definitely don't want to hold up platforms that have more capabilities than others just because we need feature parity. So we have very focused engineering groups that kind of try to push the envelope in certain circumstances where it's still within our product vision, but it may be a feature that's only available on iPad, for instance, because it's a more powerful device, so we can do some cooler things with it, if that makes sense.
Does that answer your question, man? How do you tap into the fan experience to make sure you're always on the cutting edge of that?
How?
We are fans.
We are fans. No, I think our executive leadership on down to developers and folks tasked with implementation are very much fans. And so, you know, the people that actually cut the business deals are actually some of our biggest QA testers and release of people that submit bugs into Jira are the folks that actually, one, think of these products, and two, write the checks that pay us. But it works both ways, right? So we essentially work with, of course, the content rights holder about what they want to do. We have some notional direction about, you know, working with MIT and what can be done from a scientific analytics perspective, what you can mine, to what I alluded to earlier about what you can do from a video capture perspective, what kind of physical footprint you can actually contend with and get by with on an arena, stadium, ballpark perspective. And two, we do listen to fans. We always elicit their feedback, and there's plenty of features, and these guys can attest, there's quite a few features that actually become elicited from just your everyday person that makes suggestions or recommendations.
Do you compensate for those suggestions? Or
Sometimes we hire them.
Okay, good. Jim, there's a question here. I'm sorry, as much technology aspect I deal with, technical debt.
Technical debt.
Can you define it?
Technical debt.
And how do you manage it?
Bankruptcy, constantly. you know, to Roger's point earlier, we have deadlines that don't move. Opening day does not move. And so I think every engineer who's here is probably familiar with technical debt. You cut corners, you do what you need to make your deadline. But it's important to be very prudent about that. What are you cutting, and what is the value that you're adding in order to make your deadline? Make it the most valuable thing, but be sure to build in the time later in order to remediate your technical debt. A lot of people say that they'll do that. It never ends up happening, and you end up years down the line, and somebody's cursing your name because they're looking at your username and your commit logs. But in reality, the only way to actually move forward with that, in a mature way, to build a mature system, is to actually schedule the time ahead of time to remediate your technical debt. If you're cutting a corner here in order to make your deadline, you're scheduling that, you know, a month or two out. And we find that that's actually kind of a big relief. Everybody feels like there's loose threads hanging from, you know, the code that they just built and shipped, and it gets less and less comfortable when you feel like you've got more kind of hanging on, and becomes more fragile, and everybody feels that. But the way to really take care of it is to schedule your time ahead of time to really remediate your technical debt.
Okay. Is there a question? Yes, sir. Back.
Okay, I recognize this question is going to have some repercussions. When, regardless of the franchises, the league, when do you guys think you're ready to go and distribute content without the networks, without the local broadcasters. When are you guys ready?
We clearly cannot comment on rights, ownership, and distribution beyond that.
No comment?
No comment.
Go once, go twice. So is that satisfactory to you, Vector?
I was just saying, this is when we should, but when do you guys think you're ready?
Still no comment?
That's clever, restating the same question, but yeah, we're not in a position to answer that. Again, not answered.
Jennifer's up your trunk, but they can't answer. So she's saying, no, don't answer it. So we can't put them in jeopardy. So we won't do that to you guys. We'll make sure you make it home tonight.
Have a dinner with them after.
Alex, question for you. Talk about mobile space. How has it changed over the years from your perspective and the adaptation processes that you go through?
Sure.
You're looking at those changes.
I touched a little bit on kind of teaching and learning as a culture, but obviously at MLB we have to always be on what's new. Really what's changed is Apple, Google, Amazon have kind of expanded their platforms to TV devices, mobile devices, iPads, watches, and other devices. And so really just continuing to build on these platforms and experiment and stuff. That's kind of how we stay on top of it. It helps having platform teams that are kind of software specific, not really user experience specific. So having a iOS team that works on the tvOS apps because of the technology that's used to build apps on that platform kind of gives our engineers opportunities to spread onto different devices and stuff.
Okay.
Got a question over here, if I can.
Yes.
Over here.
Gil? Hey.
Yes. Okay. Huge baseball fan, and I've got a subscription to the At-Bat app. I got the MLB.TV, all that stuff. So I guess just
you're
from
a stalker,
a,
boys, don't worry.
What's that?
You're not a stalker. Don't worry about it.
No. But every challenge of every digital media company obviously is monetizing. So I don't know if you guys know the answer to this, but outside of the advertising and the subscriptions, where does the revenue come from? And is there opportunity to grow the advertising and subscription revenue? Do you see opportunities down the road outside of just volume?
I mean, I think that's accurate. It's advertising. Well, when it pertains to DAI or in stream, mid-roll, pre-roll. I think they are ultimately two other additional angles, which are sponsored / partnered notions of distribution, and then to using the digital media side as a portion of the overall strategy instead of its own cost center. So a lot of what, some network providers or content providers are using, just leveraging their digital space to power what they do for traditional angles, is whether it's movies or broadcast television. But right now, what we deal in, particularly in the OTT space and the TV space, is strictly subscriptions and DAI. But again, the new revenue streams seem to be, very early days on what other options are available.
The teams themselves, the MLB teams, do they also contribute at all to this since it's benefiting them?
There's an original contribution they made to the company, but it all depends on the initiative. But for the most part, we actually are our own P&L. And so it's our responsibility really to maintain and build and erect the infrastructure in place to support our digital media product. But depending on the actual, there might be event-based, it might be initiative-based, there may be some contributions that they make. But from an ongoing perspective, what we do from the baseball digital media product, it's actually on our budget, our ledger.
Could you talk a little bit about audience analytics to the degree you supervise that, meaning multi-screen, you know, tracking IPs, knowing that a person's watching multiple games off of multiple devices?
Mike.
Yeah, we have, you know, pretty rich data sets for our users. Pretty much all those things you said, you know, quality of service, obviously, you know, we're focused on each user having a great streaming experience. So we look heavily at these metrics, use a lot of tools. You know, our MO is really just to try to measure everything, and there's a large data stream, you know, across all our users that we process, and we look at that data in real time.
Sure.
Will you guys ever be involved with automating the strike zone? I'll take that as a no.
I take it as a yes.
We will be involved in any initiative that baseball decides is deemed important.
I mean, we do work with the umpires, and we have that data, and we, you know, there are tools around, you know, strike zone metrics.
So how do you work with the umpires? Elaborate, please.
Well, for two key things that come to mind is obviously instant replay. So the Instant Replay Center, which expanded and rolled 2 years ago, occurs in New York City, and we built the back-end automation infrastructure so that calls actually are determined within a centralized replay, instant replay location in New York, where umpires, supervisors actually make the determination sitting side saddle with one of our operators. Another aspect that we help out with is we actually cut and trim any called pitches that assist in umpire evaluation and review of the calls they make as well. So that's also powered by a high deal of automation from our back-end systems.
So on a similar note, do you ever use any of this data for evaluation or scouting? Do teams come to you and say, we want to know about these players and how to get a competitive edge?
Yes. several of us, there's some people out in the audience, we cut so much video every six ways a Sunday, frankly, for those purposes, for both application and tying together the quality metrics that are captured from a very rich statistical level to different respective camera angles. I think the challenge is, you know, some teams would like a certain amount of IP, intellectual property, that is theirs as proprietary, so they can have some competitive advantage. But for the most part, the teams have been very open to at least extending as much as we can like technology that's available from both video and statistical analysis.
Okay. Michael, can you share some of your experiences in dealing with the teams individually and what type of activities you do and how much freedom they have in the process?
Sure, yeah.
More than 10 words, please.
I've worked on a bunch of projects where we interface directly with the teams. You know, it's interesting. You get really into the nitty-gritty of how they run their operation and run their business. But for instance, sort of bringing back to that digital ticketing initiative, you know, each team is very specific, for instance, on what needs to be on their ticket face or ticket back, and whether it be a sponsorship deal or certain terms and conditions, or, you know, they want to advertise this club seating or whatever metadata. And so we work, you know, directly with their ticket operations people, the various technology stacks that each stadium has. So what one team uses for gate entry, another team might not use, or what team's using for our point of sale system, another team might not use. And now I've worked on a bunch of projects where we're exploring new and interesting things to do with our mobile apps when you're at the stadium. And that's really a systems integration job with each team individually to figure out what systems they have, how are we going to plug them all together, how are we going to build a central platform that can, you can use your phone to scan your ticket, and then you can also scan a barcode at the POS to use eCash to buy a beer and redeem a coupon. You know, those type of investigations are sitting down with the club,
what systems do you have? Let's see specs about it. Let's brainstorm about how we can, you know, put together a solution that works for your fans and works for our larger platform.
One thing that I'd like to see as a fan is the scatter diagrams that teams use to decide whether or not to shift infielders. Do you ever see that level of granularity making it into the broadcast?
Certainly. Yeah. I mean, the data's there. It's just a matter of presenting that, but it's absolutely fair.
Yes, sir. Follow-up question? You're hired, sir, for the next hour.
Sorry, I've got two questions, really. One would be on what platforms does MLB exist on desktop? Can I see it on a Mac? Like, you have live streams, I'm assuming. Can I see an MLB on my Mac, or is that not something you support yet?
It's on the website, yeah, MLB.com.
Yeah. 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 All right, sorry, I haven't looked it up. I have limited service here. I tried. Secondly, with when you...
Yes. It's an internet connectivity issue. Right. All right, cool.
I actually have no... Sorry, I have T-Mobile. It doesn't work. And MS Guest is like lockdown. Secondly, when you're interacting with the baseball teams, I'm guessing that they're... Not to say anything bad about the individual clubs, but they probably have a less sophisticated, perhaps technological investment than MLBAM does. How do you find interfacing with these organizations? Do you have, how's that interface and how are you able to, you know, you might have source control systems and they probably are outsourcing a lot of their things to different vendors, like you mentioned, different POS systems. What are some of the challenges you have in just integrating with that and how do you, I guess, integrate their processes along with yours?
Yeah, I mean, it is a challenge for sure. The clubs vary in terms of their technology capability. Some way more capable than others. Some have more of an interest and want to invest more than others. But all are very technology enabled. So, you know, we're not, the spectrum isn't so wide that, you know, it's impossible to work with others and, you know, and they're all invested, interested in working with us. It sort of, it's just an exploration with each club. What are their capabilities? What are their goals? What systems they have in place? What vendors are they working with? You know, take it on a team by team basis. Part of the fun, just sort of getting in there, getting your hands dirty. What, you know, let's think about it, figure out what all the parties are that are involved in the problem we're trying to solve. And I enjoy that part of the job, you know, that it's very varied and which a solution that works for Cleveland might not work for the Mets.
But I would also say that, at least from a media and statistical acquisition perspective, it's a unified technological equipment footprint over a consistent network transport path. So, but for things like, you know, in park experience, you will, you know, come across some sometimes a lot of challenges from park to park. But what we capture from a media and statistical perspective is actually very uniform.
Well, how much control do you have over that? If a park is somewhat behind the others, do you have the ability to say, you guys suck, you got to do something better? Excuse my French.
I don't think we'd say that. You know, it's a partnership. I mean, you know,
Well, everybody's invested, right?
Right. We work for the clubs. So certainly we're not coming in and dictating what they do, but we have expertise and, you know, we work together to try to make suggestions where it makes sense or, you know, take their lead and sometimes where it makes sense. So yeah, certainly it's not a one-way street. We work together hand in hand and certain clubs have skill sets and certain technology sets and others are better than others. So, okay.
Yes, sir.
Along the same lines.
Hold on, can you wait for the microphone, sir?
Along the same lines, I was a data caster for MLBAM for a number of years. And the one challenge I found is from a data standpoint, especially for minor league baseball games, Generally, the data probably is only as good as the person calling in from the that particular that's either scoring that game or whoever might be calling in. What are you doing to address that sort of the data part of that situation, especially with minor league games?
As far as the human aspect of data integrity?
As accurate and the integrity of the data.
Well, they go through a review process, but ultimately the person that manages that task isn't with us to speak in any depth about what they do, but there is a review process, but I can't speak to it with a high degree of in-depth exploration.
Alex, going from 70 to 70 people, 7 to 70 people, how was that challenge for you? And what were your lessons learned?
Sure. 7 works really, really well, and it's easy to manage.
Prime number.
I had the advantage of starting when we were just building at bat, and it was brand new. And so we learned a lot doing that. Really hiring people that are very, there's no egos, and having a small tight-knit team that works on one project is kind of the takeaway. And so when we scaled up, we tried to replicate that. And because we have so many different properties now, we're able to do that. And so essentially we just kind of took this engineering pod where you've got a team lead and a group of junior to senior engineers working together on and really owning something, and created that 12 or so times. And so you've got these teams of 3 to 7 people that basically own a property. And that's kind of been how we scale. And so, you know, as you take on new properties, you essentially just spin off a new pod, if you will. And they all report up into their engineering directors. And you know, on a platform, they work really closely together. So you could be working on HBO Now and be code reviewing the people on at bat. So in that way, we're still kind of staying together. But your focus and what you own long term is centralized, and you're working with a small group. So you get kind of the advantage of having a bigger team to feed off of, but you still have that small, tight-knit group to really be a fire team to get stuff done. And it's worked really well for us. We've done it across across the organization, not just in my group, just this kind of pod structure has worked really great as we scale. So that's kind of been the big takeaway for me, is just trying to keep that small 7-person team culture alive. And I think we've done a pretty good job. Our retention has been fantastic, and we've got, you know, a lot of the people that I started with are still here, kind of running their own little groups now. So it's been a good way to scale.
Thanks, Alex, and thanks, Kevin. David's going to wrap up.
Ah, all right. Let's bring it to a wrap.
Thanks, Kevin. Good job.
Thank you, everybody.